Only in that relationship with our Heavenly Father do we find everything that satisfies us, and so He is our great priority.
Welcome to Corinth Baptist Church Sunday Worship Services with Pastor Teacher Joey Carroll.
When pastors fall into sin, they gouge out the road of the gospel. If you're born again, and yet you are unrepentant in sin and unwilling to deal with sin in your life, you're gouging out the road to advance the gospel. All right, guys, if you have your Bibles this morning, be turning to Ephesians chapter 5. We're going to look at verses 22 through 33. I am skipping 21 this morning, but we'll come back to 21 next week. But I want us to look at the longest, really one of the longest sections in Scripture on marriage, which is obviously going to teach us a great deal about marriage. And we do understand that God is gracious to the unsaved man as well as the saved man, because God will bless both of those men with the marriage relationship. However, we have to remember that for the believer, there is much more to marriage than meets the eye, and certainly with the help of the Spirit of God and the Word of God, we can understand why God designed marriage as He did. But let's look at Ephesians 5:22 and glory in another of God's designs that speaks to the glory of Christ. And as I read this, I want you to hear two words, Christ and the church. And I may swap some pronouns for Christ and the church so you can see just how many references are in this passage. Let me read it and we'll pray. Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of the wife, as Christ also is head of the church, Christ himself being Savior of the church or of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands in everything. Verse 25, husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that Christ might sanctify her, the church, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that Christ might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but cares for it, nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ, present tense, even now, does the church. Because we, the church, are members of his body. For this reason, it says, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Now, this mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you also is to love his own wife, even as himself, and the wife must see to it that she fears or respects her husband. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just praise you and thank you this morning for the opportunity that we have before us to glory in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fact that the gospel has made your bride holy and blameless before you. And Father, as we look at your word, Father, I pray that we would come with humble hearts and open minds, just willingly and joyously allowing the Spirit of God to speak to our innermost man. And I pray that we would see your glory in what you have accomplished through the gospel, and that we would celebrate in that, Father. So, Lord, we ask that you be with us even now, in Christ's name. Amen. Let me try to regain control of this. If not, I may let Tyler run it back there if he wants to. Yeah, I'll let you run it back there, Tyler. Go to 5:32. I think it's the third or fourth passage. But so when you look at these passages, after hearing all that, all those references, you understand what the main point of these passages are. In Ephesians 5:32, it says, "This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ in the church." That's what he's talking about from 5:22 to 5:33. So here's some immediate conclusions we can draw if we use marriage to symbolize the relationship that Christ has among the church. Number one, to understand more about the gospel, especially in these passages, guys, we're going to understand more about our marriage. And if I had control here, Tyler, go to the next one, the one by itself. There you go. If I had control of that slide right there, I'd draw you two circles, and on one side I'd put Christ. And you understand in the Bible that it took every color that God created and every shade of every color to see the beauty and the glory of His Son. And there's so many instances in Scripture where He tries to repaint just parts of that picture of the glory of His Son. And what we're going to look at this morning, it is the marriage relationship. And it's not going to contain every color and every shade of every color, but there are some overlapping images, if you will. And the reason that I say that is because you can't take everything that I'm going to tell you about the Lord Jesus Christ and lay it over marriage. For instance, Christ is the Savior of the church, but man is not the Savior of his wife. That's my point. But there are some glorious connections that we're going to see between the two. We're going to understand marriage more because we will understand more about the beauty of Christ, because God once again has woven yet another picture into the pages of Scripture that reflects the glory of the gospel. So the goal here is not to have a better marriage as we study these passages. The goal here is to glory in Christ and His gospel. And the reason that it's important for me to say that, for you to hear that, is because that's the difference between man-centered preaching and gospel-centered preaching. If you read these passages and you're a man-centered mindset and man-centered preaching, the title of the sermon might be How to Have a Better Marriage. But a gospel-centered preaching and a gospel-centered effort to look at these passages, a title might be something like this: Seeing and Savoring and Reflecting the Glory of Christ Through Marriage. And you really need to be able to make that distinction when you listen to people preach or when you read books. It is a vast difference between those two ways of looking at passages. Many churches have become, and we've referred to this before, I think in that movie it was The American Gospel, moralistic, therapeutic deism, trying to help you be a better you, trying to help you have a better marriage, trying to help you have a better life. That's not the gospel. And so you really got to be careful how you read the Bible and how you listen to men preach the Bible, because this is about who? Christ and the church. And so we have to understand that. In fact, don't turn there, but Paul instructs us in 1 Corinthians about the preeminence of Christ over marriage. Listen to some of these words that Paul says in 1 Corinthians 7:29. Paul says, "But this I say, brethren, that the time has been shortened, so that from now on those who have wives should be as though they had none, those who weep as though they did not weep, those who rejoice as though they did not rejoice, and those who buy as though they did not possess, and those who use the world as though they did not make full use of it." And here's why: this world is passing away. And he goes on to say, "I want you to be free from concern. One who is unmarried is concerned about the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But the one who is married is concerned about the things of the world, how he may please his wife, and his interests are divided." And he says, "Likewise, the woman who is unmarried and the virgin is concerned about the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and spirit. But one who is married is concerned about the things of the world and how she may please her husband." He says, "This I'm saying for your benefit, not to put a restriction on you, but to promote what is appropriate and to secure undistracted devotion to the Lord." And so if we find ourselves in a place of being single, you need to understand you have a greater advantage of glorifying Christ But nonetheless, even if we are, and our interests are divided, we still can understand how we can glorify Christ in the marriage relationship. So if our goal is going to be to seek to glorify Christ and His gospel in our marriage and allow God to use our marriage to reflect the glory of the gospel, then back to the question, if I do those things, will I have a better marriage? And I can answer that with an emphatic yes, but it's going to come on the far side of many years of selfless service to our spouse and humble obedience to the Word of God. Christ comes first in our marriages, and as we understand that and we put that first, we will find on the far side of glorying in Christ that God has blessed us with a beautiful, fruitful marriage. So let's focus on these things. The first thought that we come to, Tyler, I think the next slide, Ephesians 5:25. We hear these words that are the most precious to us. Christ loved the church. And in that thought, we have profound hope. Because without the love of God, there is absolutely no hope. But here we hear these beautiful words, Christ loved the church. And there's so many beautiful pictures of the love of God in Scripture. Tyler, on the next slide. The most comprehensive and largest expression of the love of God is found in John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You know, we actually mess that translation up. We minimize the love of God because the word is not world. The word is cosmos or cosmos, which means the created order of things. God says, I so love the created order of everything that I did not want it to be swallowed up by sin and rebellion and perish. So I gave my Son. It's the largest picture. God so loved the created order of all that He refused to allow all of it to die. That's followed up with one of the most personal and individual expressions of the love of God. You see in Ephesians 5:1 up there, Christ loved you and gave Himself up. So we go from Christ loved the created order of all to Christ loved you. And in that we have hope. But this morning it's a little more corporate sense in Ephesians 5:25. It is the most intimate expression of the love of God, especially considering it's in the context of marriage. Christ loved the church. So this morning I'm going to speak corporately, right? But the corporate body is made up of individuals. Individuals who are loved by God. And if you're here this morning and you haven't experienced the great, great, great love of God in the person of Christ, repent and put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And through that simple faith, you are incorporated and you now belong into a beautiful and wonderful body who is referred to as the bride of Christ. So think about those things. God loved me. God loved what He made me a part of. And God so loved His created order that what does He do? He defines His love by giving Himself up. Look in each passage. God so loved the world that He gave. 5:1, God so loved you, He gave Himself up. Ephesians 5:25, God so loved the church that He gave Himself up. So we see the definition of biblical love. It was the sacrifice of Himself. And you remember what Jesus told His disciples on the night before He went to Calvary. Greater love has no one than this, that He what? Lay down His life. It was God's love that motivated Calvary. That is biblical love. And I hope that we're moving away from thinking about love as a feeling. I'm trying so hard to get you to move in that direction because we immediately take the world's definition of love and associate it with feelings, right? We say, oh, I just love Dustin and Brittany. They're just easy to love. I just have that feeling. But I don't really love the Carols, especially the older one. You just don't feel that toward him. And so we kind of hang on to that love thing. It's just a feeling that I have. And certainly love is not without feeling or void feeling, but that's not its basis or its foundation. The basis or the foundation is love is an action that's done out of obedience to God and commitment to a covenant. And that's going to be real important when we make the turn next week and start talking about marriage. I once had a very foolish man I was counseling because he was divorcing his wife, and he said, "I just don't love her anymore." And I really wanted to scream out, "You fool, you understand nothing about love. If you're hoping to have a feeling for the rest of your life, it's not going to happen. It's not based on feelings. It's based on obedience and the commitment that you made. And that's the way it is with God. And He was so committed to us that He died. So love in Scripture is forever understood and defined at Calvary, which we made me think about election, because back in Ephesians 1, right? He chose us before the foundation of the world. And you stand there and you think, why would He choose me before the foundation of the world? Because He loved me before the foundation of the world. We want to trace that thought all the way back, but as far back as you can go is love. He loved you. In fact, in Deuteronomy 7, this is what God says to Israel. He says, "You're a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for His own possessions out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth." He says in Deuteronomy 7:7, "The Lord did not set His love on you or choose you because you were more in number than any of the peoples, because you were the fewest. But He did it because the Lord loved you." Why did the Lord choose you? Because He loved you. Why did the Lord love you? Because He loved you. That's as far back as it ever goes. And if you ever wrestle with those thoughts like I do so much, you just trace it back to love and just stand there and go, this is as far back as it goes. God loved me. God loved the church. And with that, we stand amazed. So, how does He define His love again? Christ gave Himself up for the church. And I think it's on the next slide. Ephesians 5:25. Christ loved the church and gave Himself up. And I know you know the answer to this, but let's just think about this for just a second. Why did He have to give Himself up? And it was because His bride had fallen into sin and rebellion. And to appreciate this, let's think back for just a few moments about Adam and Eve, right? God creates Adam, and then God makes him a helper suitable for Him, the text says. Her name was Eve. And then Eve sins and rebels against God. And what does Adam do? Adam responds by joining his wife in sin. It was immediate response. He sees his wife fall, and he immediately joins his bride so as not to be separated from her, and joins her in rebellion, and they both fall headlong into sin. Therefore, what can two sinners produce? Their offspring will forever be children of rebellion, children of disobedience, children of wrath. That's all they can ever produce. On the other hand, we have a far better husband that steps up to the screen or walks onto the stage. It is Christ. And we hear these words in 1 John 14, and the Word became flesh. And you go, why? Why did God have to become flesh? Because His bride was. You see, He made Himself like her. And so the Son of God took on flesh. However, the bride, what does she do? Well, like her parents, she falls into sin and rebellion. But rather joining His bride in sin, what does Christ do? He humbly submits to the Father and He walks in holiness. If you will, Christ postpones the wedding to fulfill the will of God. He puts God's glory first. And because sin and rebellion cannot be forgiven without the shedding of blood, meaning without death, Christ, rather than joining His bride in sin, first willingly assumes her guilt and her shame. He pays the debt for her sin and rebellion against God and dies in her place. He suffers God's wrath on behalf of His bride. And then God gloriously accepts the death of His Son and places the bride and raises her up from the dead. I'm telling you, we have a far better husband who is willing to put the glory of God first in order that he could raise his bride up from the dead. Now, if you'll notice with me, Ephesians 5, 26 and 27, I think it's the next slide, Tyler. Let me read this to you, and I want you to listen to the word "that," because he lays out three things that he has accomplished for us on behalf of us through Calvary. He says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church, and he gave himself up for her. Number one, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing. And then last, but that she would be holy and blameless." Let's talk about these three things for just a minute this morning. The first is the word "sanctify." Christ sanctifies his bride. And we hear that word, we've got to be careful, because some of us, sometimes we allow our theology to run ahead of the word. And we think about sanctification being that process by which you and I are made more like Jesus. But that's not how it's used in the Bible most of the time. It's a completed action at Calvary. Christ set his bride aside for the glory of God. When Christ died, he sanctified his side. He took his bride out from among all the peoples and he set her aside and said, "This one's mine." And man, if you're blessed with bride, you ought to glory in that. Because there was a day when you realized, "This one is mine." And she was set aside from all the other women and all the other girls, and she was placed in your care. That's what it means to be sanctified. Christ took a hold of her bride and he said, "This one will be mine." And he set her apart to God. Now, how did he sanctify her? There's two things in this passage that help us understand. In fact, two metaphors that are woven together. The first one is the washing of water. His death is referred to by the washing of water. His shed blood has cleansed the bride from all her impurities. You see that? He sanctified her, having cleansed her by the washing of water. Old Testament Jewish customs, the bride had a bridal bath before the wedding. So before the wedding is even here, Christ bathes his bride by shedding his blood and purifies her and cleanses her. What is it that we sing? "What can wash away my sin?" What do we say? "Nothing but the blood of Jesus." "What can make me whole again?" What is it? "Nothing but the blood of Jesus." So Christ sets his bride aside by bathing her and by cleansing her of all her impurities. And then he adds this thought, "with the word," which is in reference to the gospel that was preached to her. It was the word of the gospel that the bride heard her husband calling. And it was the word of the gospel that the bride received by faith that was given to her as well. And so through the preaching of the gospel, the shed blood cleanses the bride. And now the bride is sanctified and set apart for the glory of God. Through those two thoughts, the shed blood and the preaching of the gospel. And because she has been sanctified, Christ may now present the bride to himself in all of her glory, free from all sin, all rebellion, all defilements. She may now be presented to her husband, glorious. And glory, I would add, that was wholly given and totally unearned. Think about this, ladies, if you've been married. Oh, there was so much to do before the wedding, right? You probably hired a lady to fix your hair. And you probably hired, if it wasn't that lady, maybe a different lady to do your makeup. And then there was the fitting of the dress that you starved yourself 6 months, right? So it fit. Then the tan. You had to get the tan so you'd be dark. And you did all that for 1 minute to walk down that aisle to present yourself to your husband, right? All that work, all that money on that dress to just walk up to him and say, "Here I am. Here I am." You think about what Christ has done for her bride. She's already prepared. There is no spot. There is no wrinkle. Look at that. There is no, nothing like that whatsoever in verse 27. Any such thing. So the lady comes in to fix the hair of the bride of Christ. She goes, "Darling, there's no way I can improve upon that. Your hair's beautiful." The makeup lady comes in, looks at the bride of Christ and says, "Sweetheart, there's not a blemish on your skin. There's nothing to hide. You're absolutely radiant. How could we ever touch you? There was no need for sun or a tanning bed. Darling, you're glowing. You're absolutely perfect. Where'd you get this dress? It fits you so beautifully." The husband, he's already provided this for me. You see, Christ does all that for his bride, just in order that he might present her to himself in all her radiance and all of her beauty. And there she stands, holy and blameless before him. Hopefully without a thought of who she used to be or what she used to look like in her sin and rebellion. Hopefully all those thoughts will have disappeared and all she will know is holy and blameless before her husband in love, because he has paid for her sin and he has given her his righteousness. Before, she was not a suitor that was helpful. A suitable helper. But now she has been made suitable for her groom. She's perfect in every way, and it's all been accomplished solely by her husband, the Lord Jesus Christ, and his work on Calvary. Christ has made ready his bride. And we do not dare add anything to this all-satisfying, God-glorifying, Christ-exalting accomplishment at Calvary. It is finished. You know, I got to thinking about the accomplishment, and there's so many passages that speak about this. We've just been talking to the release time students about how God rescues his children out of Egypt, right? And he brings them out, and he's leading them out. He gets them to the edge of the sea, Red Sea, and behind him is Pharaoh and his armies. And so they're between a rock and a hard place, and they're scared to death. They just made their escape. And listen to what God says to them through Moses. He says, "Do not fear. Stand by and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today." I'm doing this. I just want you to watch. And then we hear Zacharias' words in Luke 1:68. He says, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited us and accomplished redemption for his people. He has not made salvation for a people possible, but he has accomplished salvation for his people." And then Matthew 1:21 in King James. No better translation than Matthew 1:21. "Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." He shall save his people. When I read Matthew 1:21, I think about the words of D.J. Ward. I've showed you this clip before. He's a black man, so I hear his voice in my head. I'll try to read it in my southern English and not mess this up. But listen to the words of Brother Ward when he talks about this passage. He says, "I contend this morning that the death of Christ was not an attempt. It was an accomplishment. Brothers and sisters, when one accomplishes something, it means that somewhere they had an assignment. Well, what was the assignment? His name shall be called Jesus, for he shall save, not attempt to save, not try to save, not hope to save, not want to save, but he shall save his people from their sins." He goes on, "Now I hear this, I hear it on television, I hear it in the churches, that God has done all he can do and the rest is up to you. If the rest is up to you, then he didn't accomplish it. If anything is up to you, he didn't accomplish it. I even heard it said, you got to help God save you. He can't do it by himself. If God cannot do it by himself, then he did not accomplish it. He's a false God. He's a liar, and you best not trust him. If he didn't do it, then we ought to stop singing, 'Jesus paid it all.' seeing he paid some of it. He goes on to say, if he did do it, then you can leave here rejoicing because your sins are under his blood. And he stands as your substitute, your mediator before God this morning. Did he accomplish it? Did he fail? I declare this morning, he paid it all. He paid it all. He nailed it to the cross, and I bear it no more. Amen? Amen. Christ paid it all. He called, he cleansed, he purified, he presented, and he grants us the faith to simply receive. And we are made a part of his bride. That in 5:23, Tyler, next slide, that is why he is called the Savior of the body. Christ also is head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. He came and died. His bride had been swallowed up by sin and corruption. She was under the wrath of God, but her husband has redeemed her. He has cleansed her, and he has brought her to himself, and he most assuredly has saved her completely and gloriously. But it even gets better than this. Look at Ephesians 5:30. Our husband has made him one, has made us one with himself. Because we are members of his body, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. This passage is almost always read at a wedding. And we don't understand Genesis 2:24 because we have failed to let the gospel interpret this passage. We have to understand the unity that is formed in the gospel before we can understand the unity that is formed in the marriage relationship. And if we try to understand the unity that's formed in the gospel, we will better understand the unity in the marriage covenant. Nevertheless, through the gospel, you and I have been made one with Christ. He's joined us to himself. So now we share two things with our husband. He became flesh in order to join us. And then he imputes to us or gives us his righteousness. So now we are of one flesh and we are of one holiness. Christ's bride has certainly been made suitable for her Savior. We share with our Savior. We're not done yet. A couple of more things. He has not sat down and been a lazy husband. No, he continues to minister to our needs. In Ephesians 5:29, Tyler, notice what it says. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but he nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church. Our Lord doesn't stop. He doesn't come home from work and sit down. He continues to meet our daily needs. He is our strength. He is our supply. He is our protection. He is our provision. He feeds us. He sustains us. He's promised to return for us and to take us to be where he is, where we will have everlasting joy. He's made us one. He continues to serve us and minister to us. And the last thing, and really this last thing on the next slide, Tyler, this last thing should really come without saying. 5:23, notice, Christ also is head of the church. And then it says, he himself being the Savior of the body, but as the church is subject to Christ. So we understand this thought in both directions. Christ is the head of the church, and the church is subject to Christ. The question is, how is Christ head of the church? Well, I hear this business about being congregational-led, or deacon-led, or elder-led, or pastor-led, and we ought to clasp our hands over our mouths and repent. We are Christ-led, period. Well, how does Christ lead the church then? Well, let me ask you, how did God the Father lead the Son? Did he not fill him with his Spirit? Did he not give him his Word? Did Christ not humbly submit himself to every word the Father spoke? The Father led the Son through the Word. How does the Son lead the bride? Through the Word. Through the Word. It's how Christ leads us. And so our only task is to understand what he has said in his Word. No part of the church is outside the authority of Christ. In no area or in no instance do we ever operate independently of Him. This is the authority. And if you ever think that we get away from this in any measure, you're the one, no matter how young, that needs to say, are we really following the authority of Christ here? Are we shooting from the hip? He is our head and we are subject to Him. And what a fine husband we have to submit to. For certainly He has loved us to the fullest measure. He has accomplished everything on our behalf. He continues to minister to us. Should we not willingly lay down ourselves at His feet in holy submission? His love has proven to be immeasurable. His sacrifice unquestionable. His work all sufficient. And do we not owe in exchange our humble obedience and submission to Him as Lord? We ought to follow Him wholeheartedly, listen to Him willingly, and with reckless abandon, church, we should humbly obey His word and boast about His great love wherever He sends us. We have a fine husband indeed. He has made us ready. And the wedding is yet to be, right? The wedding is yet to be. But Christ was first willing to glorify the Father in order that He might raise His bride up from the dead and be joined to Him forever. Let's pray.